Welcome to Green and Red, scrappy politics for scrappy people, a regular podcast on radical, environmental and anti-capitalist politics, brought to you by Bob Bazanko and Scott Park.
Welcome to the silky smooth sounds of the Green and Red podcast. I am Scott Parkin, co-host, coming to you today from sunny blue skied Berkeley, California. And as always, I am joined by
Bob Bazanko in Niles, Ohio.
So, and we have
good to be back. And again, as always, we want to thank all our listeners and for all your support, and please listen and share these things too on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and everywhere else. We have great guests and we want them to get the largest audience possible.
And if you're listening to us on one of the podcast platforms we're on, also please check us out on YouTube, our newest channel, and hit subscribe.
Yep. Subscribe.
Ben Shapiro has 1 million YouTube followers and our goal is to beat Ben Shapiro.
So we're getting there. We're getting close. Yeah, we're getting close.
Yeah. We have a different take on the WAP. Just going to put that out there. All right. And we're very excited today. We're going to do, some folks really appreciate the more history-minded episodes that we do. And so today we're joined by a longtime friend, Professor Jack Downey. And we're going to talk about Dorothy Day and the Catholic Worker Movement. Jack is the John Henry Newman Chair in Roman Catholic Studies at the University of Rochester. He teaches courses on contemporary justice movements, liberation theologies, North American religious history, Christianity, Buddhism, and contemplative traditions. And he is the author of The Bread of the Strong, a study of the influences on Dorothy Day and the Catholic Worker Movement. And his current research projects examine self-immolation, forms of protest, violence, Roman Catholicism in Alaska and Québec, and asceticism. I may have said that wrong. But welcome to the Green and Red podcast, Jack.
Thank you, Scott and Bob. Happy to be here.
Yep.
Appreciate the opportunity.
Oh, yeah. And so we're going to talk about Dorothy Day. For folks who are just learning about Dorothy Day, she was an American journalist, social activist, anarchist. She, at 30, she became a Catholic Christian without any way abandoning her social or anarchist beliefs. She started a radical newspaper called The Catholic Worker and began opening what she called houses of hospitality for those who needed to eat and somewhere to stay. She advocated against the state and talked about communities of communities and mutual aid actually playing the role of helping the poor, et cetera. I'm gonna hand it off to Jack. Jack, do you wanna just start telling us a little bit about Dorothy Day's background?
Sure, yeah, I'll give a quick introduction and please interrupt me as you see fit. I think I'll just like start off by saying that I'm a religious studies person. One of my primary interests in Dorothy Day and the Catholic Worker Movement and kind of adjacent Catholic, so-called Catholic left movements has, one of the central interests has been the ways in which protest can be considered liturgical or, prayerful, right? And you see in a lot of, in many movements, contemporary indigenous movements, of course, the civil rights movement very prominently, the incorporation of conceptions of prayer into organizing and activism. And you see this also in the kind of Catholic right, or even kind of like the mainstream middle Catholic perspective, which in something like the March for Life, where the rhetoric of prayer is heavily interwoven with civil disobedience or direct action in some kind of way, in ways that I find troublesome. My interest in the Catholic Worker stems from a curiosity around the specifically religious dimensions of activism that Dorothy Day incorporated into her kind of her worldview once she converted to Catholicism. So just some kind of basic outline of her life. She's born in 1897 in Brooklyn, but grows up in Oakland. Her family moved to the Bay Area. Her father was a journalist who mostly wrote.
Oakland. another claim to fame.
He focused on mostly horse racing and other sports. And in 1906, following the San Francisco earthquake, they packed up and moved to Chicago. So although she got her first early years in San Francisco, she spent most of her childhood in Chicago. Retrospectively, Dorothy Day was a prolific writer in her kind of adult life. And so she actually wrote two memoirs. And retrospectively, she would recall the San Francisco earthquake as a kind of catalyst for her kind of proto understanding of the possibility of mutual aid and the disposition of humans towards self-sufficiency and mutual support outside of the state. Presumably that wasn't what she was thinking necessarily when she was 7 years old, but it impressed on her psyche in a particular way. While she's in Chicago, she also spends a lot of time actually kind of pushing her younger siblings around in the Chicago meatpacking district. And again, kind of retrospectively in her memory, this impresses on her. Also, you know, in dialogue with Upton Sinclair's book, The Jungle, you know, a sense of worker exploitation, but also the inherent rights of and dignity of work. And they, you know, spends 2 years in college at University of Illinois, Urbana, and then moves to New York City, where she starts off a short, I guess, kind of minor career as a journalist for several left magazines, you know, The Masses and The Call, kind of most prominently. And during this period of time, so, you know, we're talking around 1916, 1917, she kind of throws herself into, I mean, what some historians have talked about is like the bohemian downtown scene in New York City. And, you know, through this work, right, she's drawn further and further into left politics and labor politics in particular, and has a series of, I guess, relationships with semi-famous people like Mike Gold, but also the poet Eugene O'Neill. And during this period of time, which she later thinks of as her kind of wandering life, she talks about it as almost like a, she in retrospect, she frames her early life as a kind of facsimile of the life of St. Augustine of Hippo in his Confessions, right? Which happens, you know, in the fourth century in Algeria. But Augustine's Confessions are so instrumental for determining and I think kind of setting together an archetypal narrative of Christian life, that as an adult who's converted to Christianity, Day can't help but read her own life back through that prism, right? So as Augustine discusses, and this is also Augustine actually reading his life back into the narrative of the Apostle Paul, Augustine frames his early life as this kind of wandering, wayward life that eventually is lifted into a higher plane through God's grace, right? And Dorothy Day talks about this time in New York City prior to her conversion as being one that's filled with this kind of like charismatic enthusiasm for liberation and solidarity and, you know, organizing, but also one that's pretty debaucherous, right? And I think one of the things that is interesting about the way that she frames this part of her lifestyle is that it's been adopted by, and we can talk about this later, people who are really pushing for her canonization to be, you know, a saint in the Roman Catholic Church. So this whole framing of the quote unquote debauched lifestyle of her early life, I mean, really sounds like a pretty normal lifestyle in a sense, right? But not if you're kind of attempting to force it into a narrative of sainthood. so, you know, through all of this, she eventually settles down and moves to Staten Island and is living with a biologist named Forster Batram, who introduces her to the kind of wonders of the natural world. Batram is, you know, an avowed atheist and anarchist who's, you know, thrown into like severe depression after the execution of Sacco and Vanzetti. And, you know, Day is kind of observing both his like commitment to the created world and is falling deeper in love with him, but is eventually starting to turn more and more towards a consideration of the supernatural. And she writes in her memoirs about how, you know, stumbling home, you know, after, you know, close to sunrise, after a night of drinking, she would see like laborer, you know, working class people kind of shuffling into churches to go to mass before they go to work. And sometimes she would sneak in while she was still hammered and kind of sit in the back of the church and just kind of like revel in the mystery of the pre-Vatican II liturgy. And this starts to impress on her, in addition to a kind of growing sense in her relationship with Forster Batram, of a kind of supernatural world that exists beyond this world, but also undergirds it, right? The apparent reality of this world. Forster Batram is completely non-receptive to this kind of supernatural orientation. And he's, you know, like I said, he's an avowed atheist, but he's also an intransigent one. And by the time Dorothy Day becomes pregnant with their child, who is ends up being named Tamar, she has a series of semi-revelatory experiences which compel her to push for their child to be baptized into the Catholic Church. Batram himself is completely antagonistic towards this idea because, like a lot of Dorothy Day's radical friends, he sees the Catholic Church as being like the least anarchist institution possible. And so this causes a rift in their relationship, right? And in the narrative of Dorothy's emergence as a Catholic, because Dorothy ends up becoming baptized received into the Catholic Church herself alongside her daughter. This is the beginning of a split between the two, where Day opts for the church over against this relationship with this man that she continues to love, you know, seemingly for the rest of her life. And a kind of a break from her kind of left lifestyle. I think one of the things that's important to note in this kind of seemingly like really peculiar decision of hers is that she sees this as being a response to a supernatural vocation. But she also thinks of the church at this time as being the church of working people. And I think one of the things that's important when we talk about the Catholic Church is that, you know, people like to say, you know, it contains multitudes, but I think most of the time when people talk about the church, they're thinking about the magisterium, the, you know, the Pope, archbishops, etc., which is certainly a valid, you know, interpretation of like what that concept means. But I think for Dorothy Day, what she was thinking of actually was longshoremen and, you know, like domestic workers, the people that she would see in church, you know, at 6 a.m. on their way to work. And so what she's joining is a religion that in a sense is almost like a, you know, it's a labor religion in a sense. For the first several years of her life after converting, she has this kind of wayward, still kind of like flip-flopping because she doesn't have a religious community. And she's still involved with journalism. She, you know, attends some civil disobedience actions both in New York and in DC. You know, she's arrested for, you know, marching for the right to vote. Spent some time in jail, not a lot of time, but a little bit, but eventually is kind of match made with this like very weird, like objectively weird, everyone thought he was very weird, man named Peter Marin, who was, you know, he's kind of a fabled person in Catholic worker history, but he was French. He had been, you know, a member of what are called the Lasallian Christian Brothers, which is an intentional community, kind of like a Catholic frat, a religious order of men who are not priests, but their specialty is teachers, is teaching. And, you know, they run any number of high schools and colleges around the world. but had eventually made his way to the United States and was famous for having these like very kind of dogmatic, enthusiastic pronouncements about the nature of kind of prophetic Catholicism in the modern industrial world. And he starts, once he gets to New York, he eventually makes his way to Dorothy Day through a series of editors that essentially pawn him off on her. And between the two of them, they start to develop what becomes the Catholic Worker. Marin has this very emphatic, enthusiastic belief that what Catholicism actually is a religion of liberation for working people. This is not, you know, the dominant interpretation of what Catholicism is. Even though, you know, at the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, you see magisterial documents from the Vatican, from popes, discussing the dignity of labor, right? So the Catholic Church as an institution does respond to industrialization by emphasizing the dignity of work. But the on-the-ground kind of parish-level church operations are not prioritizing that for the most part. Marin has a plan of action that's really, you know, a socialist plan that looks at the teachings of the church, especially the gospel, and interprets that as like a program for reform. Day is highly receptive to this in ways that almost nobody else is. And so she talks about Peter Marin as a kind of quasi mystical figure. She talks our day, right? Someone who lives in poverty himself, but has a mystical relationship to poverty. And while almost everyone else in the world seems to have found him intolerable, Dorothy Day finds him like unbelievably compelling. And some of Day's friends would later say that like one of her mystical gifts was being able to tolerate Peter Marin, right?
One of her miracles.
Yeah, one of her miracles, right? So between the two of them, and Marin has, you know, he was very, he had this quote that is like clearly problematic, that is, man proposes, woman disposes, right? And he was a very stereotypical, like big ideas guy that liked to he liked to expound on things and then leave other people to kind of do the nuts and bolts work of putting things together. But one of his ideas was to create a Zine, right? Which ends up becoming the Catholic Worker newspaper, which, you know, it came out in 1933 on May Day. And this is, you know, Dorothy Day at this point was in the Lower East Side. And they were selling it for a penny a copy, which is still the price of it, actually.
Was the release on May Day coincidental or intentional?
No, it was intentional. Also, Dorothy Day is actually, her middle name is Day, ironically, but, or her middle name is May, sorry. Dorothy May Day is her. but yeah, so it was meant to be on May Day intentionally. They stole the name from the Daily Worker, right? And so they would actually like hawk their newspaper next to the people trying to get rid of the Daily Worker. As far as I can tell, at least from the record, it seems like they had a kind of playful antagonistic relationship, you know, in that sense. But for a while, they were just churning out this newspaper that essentially took a position of labor rights and socioeconomic kind of liberation, but remixed it through almost like a fundamentalist kind of Catholic, like theological perspective, in the sense that the Catholic Worker, which at this point is basically Marin and Day, start adopting a fairly fundamentalist, kind of quasi-literal, biblical literalist interpretation of Jesus's commands, particularly in the Sermon on the Mount. Now, I think, you know, when people talk about biblical literalism, usually it's deployed in a kind of conservative way at this point, right? Or, you know, like straight up like bigoted way, right? Where people will say like the Bible says this thing, therefore it's true. But the thing we all know, right, is that nobody is a complete biblical literalist. It's just not possible. So what people are doing when they say they're biblically literate literal is that they're selectively appropriating something, usually taking it out of context, and then treating that particular thread as literal. And Day does this too, and she eventually is quite open about it, that she says the Sermon on the Mount is a manifesto for Christianity. Right? And so certain aspects of the New Testament become non-negotiable for her in terms of how she kind of frames her understanding of what authentic Christianity is. And this also includes critiquing the institutional Catholic Church from a fairly early level. One of the things that she argues early on is this, you know, there's this cognitive dissonance between what she thinks the Roman Catholic Church actually is in a kind of supernatural way, and then how it appears in the material world. And so this newspaper is kind of a standalone organ of, it's the only thing that is the Catholic Worker for a time. And then organically, and this is almost mythologized, people start showing up at their printing press, which is in Dorothy's brother's apartment in Alphabet City, under the impression that there's also like housing available. And there isn't at the time, but this compels them to go and start to open up what ends up becoming known as Houses of Hospitality, which are kind of the flagship, I guess, in addition to the newspaper, the flagship organ of the Catholic Worker. First starting in, you know, downtown New York City, there's still two houses in Lower Manhattan. These Houses of Hospitality are essentially shelters. They see themselves being distinct from a lot of shelters in the fact that, at least originally, there's no time limit. There's no, you know, restriction to just evenings only. There are no barriers to entry as long as there's capacity. And then along with this then comes the next organic step, which is the development of, you know, the kind of the soup kitchen aspect of the Catholic Worker. So, you know, nowadays, and this happens very quickly, when you think of the Catholic Worker, you think of essentially either Houses of Hospitality, and there's over 200 are still in the world that are functional. You also think of soup kitchens, which are usually part of the Houses of Hospitality. And then there's the element of protest, which, you know, during the Depression and then leading into, first the Spanish Civil War and then the Second World War, becomes a kind of greater element of the Catholic Worker's identity as they start to amass more of a community. And their community is really built through the Houses of Hospitality. So eventually Day starts to see her work as being kind of two prongs. You have the Houses of Hospitality, which attends to the material needs of people who are, you know, more or less destitute. And, you know, during the Depression, the New York House is churning out, I think it's like around 600 meals a day. You have other houses, like particularly in St. Louis, at the height was putting out over 3,000 meals a day. So there's an incredible need that they're able to respond to in like fairly organic ways. The thing about the Catholic Worker is that they've like never been exceptional at like planning, because there is this supernatural element that seems to always kind of ride the edge of being how to say, superstitious, maybe. The expectation that God would provide was like a huge component of their planning for these kind of massive undertakings. They relied primarily on donations, and that included donations of food, but also donations of money to pay for heating, for coal. And oftentimes, you know, there are these kind of supernatural stories, and this is all part of the mythology, of them, you know, running completely out of money, and then all of a sudden someone donates coal, and, you know, and a truck full of coal just like pulls up to the Catholic Worker house. And the idea of the life of prayer being an intrinsic part of the House of Hospitality's functioning, that's almost kind of quasi-monastic, was an important part.
And how many houses did they have at this time and at the height? Like I read something like at least 200 houses around the country.
Well, yeah, so there's 200 now.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm not sure actually what the maximum number was. You know, it starts off in kind of major cities. You know, New York obviously is the first one, and then you know, Chicago is another one, Detroit is another one, Boston, and then there, you know, there's this kind of spread into smaller environments. Protestants, right? And so a lot of them are associated with they're kind of towns that have Catholic universities or colleges in them. In South Bend, Indiana, there's a very prominent Catholic worker house that's been in existence for a long time. Rochester's had a Catholic worker house since the early period. There's kind of like organic evolution of them, but they're still really functional in a lot of ways, or at least they exist. Functionality is a different question. So there's this element, right, of responding to immediate need, and then there's the kind of organizing, protesting element of the Catholic worker, which they see as responding to the underlying structures that create immediate need. You see this, I mean, the Catholic worker and Dorothy Day in particular, one of the things that she was fundamentalist about was her understanding of pacifism. And this is something that was controversial even within the Catholic worker, especially around World War II. The Catholic worker first really starts to antagonize the Catholic hierarchy during the Spanish Civil War, because the Catholic Church internationally, but especially in the United States, really sides with the side of the fascists, right? Yeah. Very explicitly, which is why it's always interesting to me now that the Catholic bishops, will claim, and they've been doing this since right before Kennedy's election, that Catholicism is totally like on board with democracy, it always has been. Yeah. It's just demonstrably not true, but starting with the Spanish Civil War, but moving into World War II, during the Cold War, you see the Catholic worker being kind of like intransigently pacifist, right? And for Dorothy Day, this is again an outgrowth of a supernatural life. So the Catholic Church, since the medieval period, but really since much earlier than that, has had what's called the just war tradition. Which has become adopted by, like the UN in some way, which, establishes that there are legitimate, means or situations in which it's moral to engage in military, force. And of course, the Crusades kind of push that one step further and say there's actually like, an imperative in some cases to engage in military force. What the pacifist tradition in Christianity, throughout Christian history, but in some cases the Catholic Church, and it's always been an extreme minority in the Catholic Church, rejects that whole kind of moral calculation in favor of what they see as a kind of more pure means of living life and responding to conflict, even if it's not quote unquote efficacious, right? The Catholic worker starts to, really butt heads with Cardinal Spellman, who is the Archbishop of New York, for a long time, who was a huge war hawk. Bob, you probably know that he was like really into Vietnam. And
there's a good book on that, The American Pope.
Yeah, exactly.
Long time ago, but yeah.
Yeah, and so this begins this longstanding antagonism between Dorothy Day and Spellman. Spellman also, is anti-labor. He conscripts some of his seminarians to break the gravedigger strike. So he uses future priests as scabs. This is a longstanding kind of conflict that the two of them have. Although the interesting thing is that, Spellman has all of the actual institutional power. And Dorothy Day, if you see the way that she deals with him throughout, several decades, she's very skillful at essentially avoiding shutting down the Catholic worker. Because even though the Catholic worker is not an official organ of the institutional church, there is a way in which Spellman has an authority over her just by virtue of his position in the church. So I think those elements of kind of Day's understanding of the Catholic worker that come out in the early decades really persist through most of the rest of the 20th century. Now, by the time we get to Vietnam, Day is already like fairly old, right? I mean, she's in her 60s. She's already an established figure. She's well known. She's in some ways kind of removed from the daily work of the house of hospitality that she lives in. She's spending a lot of time on the road. She's giving talks. She's already being treated as someone special. And is kind of like a, almost like a mother superior in a kind of like monastic context, it seems like. she continues, right, with the Catholic worker position on pacifism in regards to Vietnam, but also I think perhaps her most useful or enduring contribution to that period of time is her mentorship of people like the Berrigan brothers, Dan and Phil Berrigan, who essentially in a way take the reins from her as kind of icons of Catholic left anti-war activism. And they really push in a lot of ways like the more tactical element of liturgical protests. The Catholic worker, especially when in kind of day's fullness, their protests were largely pickets, you know. During air raid drills, they would refuse to participate in the air raid drills. In some cases, there was several years where they would annually go out and have a picnic during the air raid drills. So there's this kind of like non-compliant civil disobedience. But the Berrigan brothers and, you know, what emerges out of their movement in the 60s, by the 1980s, you get the Plowshares movement, which still exists as a kind of almost offshoot of the Catholic worker, is much more interested in direct action in terms of sabotage, right? And forms of like direct conflict and bringing bringing their vision of kind of evangelical Catholicism to organs of destruction rather than just non-compliance, right? And they're famously also like very sanguinary in terms of their aesthetics, right? And so, yeah. Starting with the, you know, draft boards, the Berrigan brothers have this like interesting innovation tactically of using their own blood to pouring their own blood on things. And this continues too, right? With the Plowshares movement, essentially trespassing on military property and using their own blood as part of, kind of graffiti, a kind of supernatural graffiti. So I think one of the things that Day does is she pulls back quite a bit and allows the Berrigans to move forward and develop their own style of, really like kind of cult of personality in terms, especially Dan Berrigan within the Catholic left. Day herself, she dies in 1980. She's famously arrested in 1973, quite old, at a United Farm Workers protest that she's out in Fresno with Cesar Chavez. And there's this iconic photo of her, very old, fairly withered, sitting on a folding chair being surrounded by police officers. And for a lot of people who I think really see her as sacred, like a sacred person, this is one of the iconic images that I think is kind of indelibly, part of like the vision of almost like a mystical figure that they have. Like I said, she dies in 1980, and I think there's this period of, I think maybe still ongoing period of trying to understand like what the Catholic worker is without Dorothy Day. Like I've said, there's still over 200 houses that are still operative. I think on a daily level, there's obviously quite a bit of diversity within those communities, and I've only been to a fraction of them. So I can't really speak authoritatively, but as I understand it, the Catholic workers that I know, continue to do the work that they've been doing, they often do it in a way that's very unceremonious, very quiet, and incredibly consistent, but also I think really countercultural, even within the kind of left, in terms of providing services without advertising them in a lot of ways. And there's also the continuation of the Plowshares movement, right? There's every couple of years there's an example of Plowshares actions that make it onto the news. I think there's the Catholic worker No Dapple saboteurs, right? Who very like publicly assaulted the Dakota Access Pipeline, and I believe their case is still pending.
And they were they lived and worked in a Catholic worker house in Iowa in Des Moines.
Yeah, Des Moines.
I believe. Yeah.
Yeah, they have actually. Democracy Now, they have this like very lovely interview where they explicitly, very explicitly talk about how they sabotage the pipeline.
And then there was also a nun recently facing, like, who was maybe in her 80s or 90s, who was facing a significant amount of time for the a plowshares action or plowshare style action in Tennessee.
Yeah, so that's Sister Megan Rice is the one that you're talking about, I believe. And so this is in 2012, right? This was in Oak Ridge, Tennessee. It was three activists, Megan Rice, Greg Bertajay Obed, and Michael Wally, who trespassed in the Department of Energy national security complex. So, you know, Oak Ridge is like, was one of the main sites of the Manhattan Project and still functioning. Right. And they shut down the weapons facility, again, using their own blood in addition to banners. Megan Rice at the time was 82 years old when that happened. And so this was a plowshares action.
To get back to Dorothy Day a little bit, a lot of people assume that she's like this sort of like typical leftist, but in a lot of ways she's like deeply conservative, and there's, you know, there's like contradiction. There's where she was a radical pacifist who refused to pay taxes, but, you know, also like was still very much a Catholic traditionalist, also, you know, identified as an anarchist, but also like traditional under like an all-male Catholic leadership. How does she straddle these worldviews?
Well, so it's a good question. I remember seeing an interview with one of the people who, you know, so a lot of the people that have ended up like writing about Dorothy Day or making films about Dorothy Day are people that have known her for a long time. In many cases, they're people that were young adults, you know, kind of in her heyday, mm-hmm. and left their lives, you know, dropped out of college and joined the Catholic Worker, and now are in a position where they're like, you know, grown adults and they can speak authoritatively from their experience. And I remember seeing one person state that, you know, she just didn't see that there was a problem, like any sort of conflict, which in a way, you know, I spent like a lot of time reading her mail and in her diaries. And so I feel like in a weird way, like a historian does, right? You feel like you get to know somebody in a kind of intimate way, especially if you're reading their diaries. And I can see her kind of being glib or laconic and kind of just saying something like that, like it's not a problem, and then just kind of moving on. But, mm-hmm. you know, she did her first publication was a novel, actually. It was like sometimes called a semi-autobiographical novel. Mm-hmm. But her second publication was an entire book that was, it's called From Union Square to Rome, that was written for essentially as a letter to her brother explaining like why the hell she became a Catholic, right? So it's very clear that she at least realized that there was like an apparent conflict. You know, one of the things I find that's like helpful to think about is that she really, she doesn't fit into like the standard vision of what a leftist would be like or what a progressive is. I don't think those terms really apply to her very well. In a lot of ways, she was very traditional, right? And she enters into Christianity, you know, because she was raised in a nominally Episcopalian household, but she wasn't raised with any kind of like real religion. And so she becomes a Christian really through like reading medieval texts, right? Mm-hmm. or earlier texts, right? And she comes with this kind of like literary romanticism, but in a way that's also very pious, right? Some mm-hmm. of the books that were most influential on her, you know, is like, one of them is like Thomas a Kempis's Imitation of Christ, which is, you know, it's a medieval text that's like deeply pious. And so she has this very strong sense of like sin. And, you know, you see this with the way that she writes about herself. This is also something I think she might get from Augustine, you know, who's kind of credited with developing what becomes known as original sin as a concept, of the kind of the deep finitude of human life, right? Which is almost ironic because you normally think of an anarchist as being stereotypically optimistic about human nature, whereas she's deeply pessimistic. And she's, you know, she's alleged at some points to be almost heretical in her pessimism about human nature.
Right. Gonna cue up the video here in a second. I find her sort of outlook that she had like later in life, which is gonna be kind of come out in this video that I'm gonna play, actually like somewhat in, I actually feel like it's fairly instructive for what one, how she sees the world, but then two, is that like, you know, we're in this period where we're all really wanting like the government to intervene here and there. And she's like actually kind of like really kind of sticks to like her sort of like, you know, liberatory anarchist beliefs that like it's communities and mutual aid, which are actually going to make the difference. And I find that, you know, she, well, I'll play this video real quick. This is Dorothy Day, folks, from, it's a interview probably in the late 60s.
Early 70s.
And the Cesar Chavez movement in the West Coast, they wouldn't like to have it labeled in that way. But I think that their names are so familiar to people, both in the union field, which interests me very much because I think that it's beginning to work from the bottom up instead of from the top down. Everybody looks to the state and looks to the state for funding and looks to the state to keep our schools going, always turning to the state. And the state isn't supposed to be functioning in this way. Martin Buber says the state should be a community of communities. And certainly the popes have said that the state should never do what smaller bodies can do. And here when unions and credit unions and cooperatives are the basis of man's mutual aid and working together, it's an entirely different political point of view, and it makes for peace.
Ms. Day, you sound very hopeful. Besides the...
And, yeah, I mean, I actually found that, like, somewhat inspirational because sometimes I feel like some of these, like, kind of figures who are more radical, who are actually more radical in truth, or have been, like, sort of, like, co-opted by this sort of, like, liberal frame. It's a little bit like King, right? So, like, King actually, at the end of his life, actually talked quite a lot about, like, you know, socialism and, you know, economic justice as much as racial justice. And seems like a similar sort of dynamic also happens with Dorothy Day.
Yeah, I mean, I think one thing that we could talk about later is the question of, like, Day being co-opted by liberalism. But, you know, like, she gets her idea of particular type of personalism, I think partially from her like pre-conversion life, right? Her like, you know, her pre-conversion radicalism. It's also influenced by, I think, a kind of like medieval romanticism, some of which she gets from Peter Marin and some of which she gets from reading about the notion of, you know, micro kind of communities. And then actually also the, you know, there's this principle in Roman Catholicism that starts to become like more and more, at least kind of named, if not actually really followed up on, which is subsidiarity, which is, you know, the notion that government should happen on the lowest scale possible or the smallest scale possible, which also stands in contrast to, you know, a lot of other things in Catholic history. But, you know, for Day, her notion of personalism, right, is this kind of immediacy that demands on, as like a practice, as both a, you know, a program for social reform or, you know, revolution, but also as like a personal spiritual practice, the immediacy of responding to like immediate need. And then, you know, along with that, like a distrust of the state. So I think, yeah, all of those things do kind of like come together, but Dave is also like incredibly, I think, consistent about that, you know, from the get-go, which is why it's interesting that oftentimes she is like fairly, I do think in some ways, like King, like she is co-opted potentially if she becomes a saint in a more institutional, like structured, formal way. You know, but in 1948, she writes an essay in the Catholic Worker, says, "We are un-American, we are Catholics." I mean, it's like pretty, and that was the front page of the Catholic Worker. And, you know, there's a way in which I think she's incredibly consistent about this principle. And, you know, in like a real material way, right? I mean, this was the basis for the houses of hospitality, was this notion that like the state is not going to save us, right? And neither is like neither are the bishops, you know. And so the Catholic Worker, this is why the Catholic Worker was never actually incorporated as like like within the actual structure of the Catholic Church, even though obviously like it's it kind of like floats semi-independently. But there's a mistrust of the institution of the church itself, which Day used to say, you know, like the church is the cross that Christ was crucified upon, even while maintaining, you know, a relationship to that church.
I grew up, you know, Catholic. And so Day and Berrigan, people like that, had kind of an outsized reputation, probably more on the left than as Catholics. But since then, I mean, I don't know if it's because people like them, you know, aren't as well known. I guess Martin Sheen would be the closest to anybody like them nowadays. But you've seen clearly the Vatican take a really hardcore right turn very openly with John Paul and then Benedict and groups like Opus Dei and this woman who may be appointed to the Supreme Court as part of a Catholic society I wasn't even aware of.
Yeah.
And so, you know, clearly in the last, I don't know, couple generations at least, we associate Catholicism with this kind of very hardcore, almost, you know, kind of like the evangelicals. I think they're one of Trump's main bases of support. Yeah. You know, what accounts for that? Like, because they're, you know, growing up, my dad used to take me to union labor council meetings, and there were always priests there. They were very active in the labor movement. They go out on the picket line, pray with people and stuff like that. And the church doesn't really even pretend it. Catholic liberals try to point out that pro-life can mean more than abortion, but they don't seem to get very far. So what accounts for that transformation from a church that at least tolerated the types of Berrigan and Day to one now that's really kind of a hardcore element of this really reactionary constituency?
Well, so I think, I mean, on one level, like it is important to note that, like, I agree, like they clearly did in some ways like tolerate the Catholic Worker. All of the people who reported Dorothy Day to the FBI starting in 1941 were Catholics. And, you know, and so if you look at like the letters to J. Edgar Hoover, I mean, initially, actually, by 1943, there's a letter from Hoover that, you know, they think that she's a Russian, like they think she's Russian, actually. Yeah. And so there's this interesting early part of the 1940s where J. Edgar Hoover thinks that she's like a Russian spy who's been sent to convert people, et cetera. But all of the letters to Hoover are like, you know, Jimmy, Irish guy from New Jersey, who's, you know, like, who thinks this is part of a communist plot. Right, and the way in which the Catholic Worker fits into Catholic anti-communism is very interesting, right? Because part of the narrative around Dorothy Day is that she leaves communism to become Catholic, which isn't really like that's not a really historically accurate way of thinking about it. But I think in terms of your question, you know, in the post-Vatican II era, so if we're talking, you know, mid '60s onward, right, and this is global, or especially in like kind of, you know, Western Europe and North America, right? You see this like real evacuation of the Catholic Church by the white Catholic people, right? So I think when we're talking about like the Catholic Church's turn, you know, there's one way in which, you know, like black and brown Catholics are almost completely left out of the conversation about like what's happening to the Catholic Church. And there's like 20 million Hispanic Catholics in the country, right? But I think the decided turn in terms of the outward face of the church, you know, which is, you know, the bishops, partially comes from, you know, the almost like a kind of condensing of the church's sense of like who it is, right? So it ignores in a lot of ways, like black and brown Catholics. And then it sees like who's left over. It's mostly people who haven't left the Catholic Church, right? Like I know a ton of people who are organizers now who are ex-Catholics, you know? Sure. So I do think that there's this almost like a distillation process. Now, part of this is institutionalized through John Paul II and then Benedict XVI. And Benedict XVI himself was very open to the idea of a leaner, meaner Catholic Church. He basically said as much, you know. He did not have an interest in a notion of, you know, Catholic Church as like, here comes everybody, right? Which was kind of like a previous aspiration, right? He treated Catholicism as a denomination and not as a universal church, which had been its position for a long time. Sure. And so I think you see there a hardening of a certain type of culture warrior mentality it also becomes structural because JP II and Benedict XVI, right, are also instituting bishops who are kind of in their mold. And so, especially in the United States, those bishops are given license essentially to transform the church kind of in the image of John Paul II, to the point now where you have, you know, Pope Francis, who is relatively progressive, but he would still be my most conservative friend, you know, being essentially kind of stonewalled by some of the earlier appointees, right? I do think you're right, though, in pointing out that, like, the Catholic Church, especially the kind of, like, you know, the white Catholic Church has been, and this goes back even to, you know, I remember when The Passion of the Christ came out, right, that, like, kind of in league with evangelicalism, right, in a way that would have been really unimaginable before Vatican II. So one of the things that Vatican II does is that it opens up the Catholic Church on an institutional level to interdenominational relationships. It also precipitates a real kind of with, like, explosion of people leaving the church who had been, you know, coming from Catholic families. And so then what you have left is a kind of like a leaner, meaner Catholic Church that sees itself antagonistic towards the modern world, which, you know, which the bishops had been suspicious of Americanism for a long time anyway. I mean, this is, you know, Americanism in the late 19th century was condemned as a heresy by Rome. But the kind of so-called Vatican II era priests become fewer and far between. Now, there's a lot of reasons why people think Vatican II might have done this. One of the theories is, you know, a kind of a cost-benefit analysis. Once Vatican II, you know, quote unquote, opens up Catholicism to the world, being Catholic is no longer seen as essentially worth the risk, right? So the clergy change. The clergy become much more conservative. There's a backlash. Some people would dispute how that's framed. Immediately after Vatican II, when Pope Paul VI, who takes over control of the church during Vatican II, starts to publish the text Humanae Vitae, which is the church's formal, you know, pelvic region teaching, right? Which, you know, talks about contraception, talks about, you know, abortion, talks about women's rights, reproductive rights, or the lack thereof in terms of its position. And that leads the laity to essentially ignore it, right? The Catholic people have never practiced contraception at a different level than the rest of the American population. And so one of the things that you see here then is the beginning of the laity essentially feeling empowered to ignore the teachings of the Catholic Church. Eventually, this also leads a lot of them to leave the Catholic Church. Now, part of this also then, I feel like I'm just making it more complicated, but another factor is also the child abuse scandal, right? And Scott mentioned at the beginning of the hour that, you know, one of the things I look at is Alaska. The thing I'm looking at in Alaska is the abuse crisis in Alaska. But, you know, you start to get the first kind of national stories coming out about priests abusing children in the mid 80s. And these are stories from much earlier, but, you know, some of the survey data shows that, you know, churches teaching on sex, contraception, sexuality, homosexuality, et cetera, and abuse are two of the most prominent reasons why people leave the Catholic Church. But then the question is, who stays? The people for whom those are not deal breakers, right? And, you know, that's also kind of woven into the church's sense of a kind of siege mentality, which puts it in league with conservative evangelicalism. So I mean, those are some of the elements. Like, if you go to the seminaries, and, you know, I actually know some, like, really good young priests who I think would be, like, politically on board with everything that we've been talking about today. But a lot of the seminaries are much more conservative than their instructors are, right? Because, you know, I think there's a good question of, you know, the life of a priest is a really hard one, right? You give up a lot. You know, assuming you're a good priest, right? We're talking, or like, you follow the rules, you know, keep your vows, then you're essentially giving up, you know, most of what are the essential parts of a social life for a young person. And the person that's going to have that kind of drive as a 19-year-old or a 20-year-old is the type of person who's going to really elevate that role. And, you know, seems like most liberal people, like, don't have that kind of cost-benefit analysis. And so a lot of the seminaries are packed with people who are culture warriors, right? Because that's the thing that can animate them. And so that means that the priests then in the parishes are going to be more trending more conservative.
Just real quick, we want to do a quick station ID moment to identify that you're listening to Professor Jack Downey from the University of Rochester, talking about Dorothy Day and the Catholic Worker Movement on the Green and Red podcast. And you can become a patron at patreon.com/greenredpodcast. You can also, that's where you become a recurring donor. If you want to make just a one-time donation, you can go to greenandredpodcast.org. Also, please follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. And then we also have a new channel, which is YouTube. We'll be posting this video as well as many other videos on YouTube. So please go to our YouTube channel, Green and Red Podcast, and become a subscriber. And we have a small but mighty growing audience on YouTube. And I'm going to pass off to Bob for more.
Yeah, a minute ago you mentioned the growth of Catholicism in kind of non-American, non-European areas. And a few decades ago, I think, you know, if you wanted to look at the issue of Catholic activism, in fact, it would be like in Central America,
right? You
know, especially with the Sandinista government. A couple things. I know that they often refer to Merton and others, but did they have kind of was Dorothy Day really that influential on kind of the liberation theology movement in that area? And I'm not naive about the Catholic Church, their role and the Vatican's role, and especially going after communist movements in places like Spain or Italy or Poland. But did the emergence of groups like the Sandinistas or other priests like Romero force the Vatican to kind of ratchet up their repression as well?
Yeah, so I think Latin American liberation theology, in a way, is fine without Dorothy Day's immediate influence, right?
I was just curious. Yeah.
No, I mean, which is to say that, you know, I think there's like remarkable similarity, right? And you know, in some ways, like I read, like liberation theology has been much more successful than Catholic worker theology, if you could call it that, in terms of like creating like a almost like its own institution, right? You know, in the world of theology, there's now this proliferation of all forms of different liberation theologies, right? A lot of which, you know, trace back to, you know, the 60s in Latin America with like someone like Gustavo Gutierrez, or, you know, Black liberation theology with someone like James Cone, right? Both Cone and Gutierrez like published their early works at basically the same time, and you know, using really similar frameworks, although like inflected with their own experience. There's a lot of resonance with that theology and the Catholic worker theology, you know? And so in a lot of ways, I think of the Catholic worker as almost, especially like Day's earlier writings in the 40s, et cetera, as being almost like a proto-liberation theology. And I think, you know, there is, as time kind of marches on, there's a lot of interpenetration between liberation theology and the Catholic worker. You know, and especially if you think about someone like Oscar Romero, you know, is revered by Catholic workers, right? And other, you know, all sorts of Catholics, but, you know, Oscar Romero is now officially a saint, but he was canonized unofficially by the Catholic worker a long time ago. And so there is that kind of interpenetration, but it is also kind of remarkable to me that in different times and places, these forms of reading Christianity emerge that are not initially, at least, you know, connected, right? They're actually, they start to meet in ways that are, once they're already more or less formed. And so I do think that there's a lot of synergy, but in a sense, there's not like causality, right? And I think liberation theologians would point then to that being evidence of like almost like a universalist kind of truth that's pointing to, you know? And could you remind me of the second question about around Romero?
Well, it was basically just, you know, kind of how the attack on like Cardinal and Romero really kind of amped up the you know, I've talked about this a lot. I grew up Catholic and was an altar boy and all that stuff and luckily escaped. But, you know, it always seemed to me that obviously things like abortion are massive issues in Catholic politics. But kind of Cold War. What's that?
Didn't used to be, though, you know?
No, I mean, when I, you know, kind of came of age, it was really like Cold War and communism, which was really kind of the dividing line. And that's kind of, you know, when I saw these kind of, in some cases, very vicious right-wing Catholics, you know, kind of emerge more, far more publicly than ever before.
Yeah, and I mean, and, you know, not for nothing, I mean, that has basically persisted. I mean, you know, Romero, you know, and Gustavo Gutierrez was only like officially kind of like invited, I mean, it was symbolic, but invited back to the Vatican, you know, within the last few years.
Yeah.
And, you know, like, there have been several liberation theologians who've been like formally censured, et cetera. There's, you know, I think one of the things that was particular about liberation theology in Latin America and then also the Catholic Worker is the sense of a suspicion that they were organs of communism, like kind of like from within, right? And so I think that was the real kind of like generative aspect of the vigor that they were kind of persecuted, right? Was the, especially with someone like Romero, this, right? The notion that communism was kind of infecting Catholicism. And the liberation theologians, you know, especially, you know, famously in like El Salvador, but also, you know, farther afield, right? I think partially because the leadership or the face of liberation theology was often priests and bishops in Romero's case, right? That they were subjects to much more heavy kind of venom from the magisterium because they had taken vows of obedience, right? That they're, you know, ultimately had subjected themselves to the kind of authoritarian, and I'm not even saying that as a pejorative term, like the authoritarian power of the Vatican. Whereas the Catholic Worker, you know, had not, and I think Dorothy Day benefited quite a bit in some ways from being like a lay woman who was a convert, right? Because A, like she hadn't grown up being socialized into the hierarchical structure of the Catholic Church. So she didn't have a kind of like, I mean, blind obedience that's too like pejorative a way of talking, but she hadn't been socialized into obedience at all, really. And also because she was a lay person and because she was a woman, she wasn't taken as seriously in a lot of ways. By the bishops as she would have if she was a male priest. And you see this with Dan Berrigan, you know, after the self-immolation of Roger Laporte in 1965 in front of the UN, you know, Berrigan, there's this whole controversy around whether Dan Berrigan was banished because of, by Cardinal Spellman because of this. But Berrigan, you know, is not actually banished to Latin America, but he kind of escapes. His superior tells him to go to Latin America for several months and he comes back having studied with liberation theologians, and he comes back further radicalized. But part of his whole kind of mystique, and I mean, this is true for Phil Berrigan before he leaves the priesthood, is the fact that there are these like quote unquote renegade priests, but they're renegade because they're operating within this almost like military structure of the Catholic Church, which is what was, you know, most of the liberation theologians in Latin America were also at least nominally subjects to. So, you know, I think the idea of communism really like infecting the priesthood in Latin America was the thing that, you know, was completely unacceptable to the anti-Catholicism of the era. Because, I mean, I think it's hard for people, I mean, you were, you know, raised in a Catholic family. I think it's hard for people who like don't have any connections to Catholicism to really appreciate like how anti-communist Catholicism was on a global scale, right? That this was not just, you know, I mean, they saw it as a religious supernatural battle, right? The Catholic Church is, of course, is like technically its own state in some ways, but they really saw this as a cosmic conflict. And so people who were engaging in activities that they saw as being kind of communist light or communist inflected or even just straight up communist were both seditious on a political level, but they were also heretical on a supernatural level. And so then you have this like real deep investment in combating this as part of like essentially a crusade, right? We're talking about a crusade. And, you know, this is why I think eventually I have a lot of mixed feelings about Pope Francis, but, you know, one of the things that he has done, right, is really kind of reach out to that wing, at least in terms of symbols, which is what the papacy is really all about, right? Which is like symbols, you know, the canonization of Romero also reaching out to other liberation theologians from Latin America, which, you know, is kind of where he comes from, even though he's Italian by, you know, background, you know, is some sort of like rapprochement with that part of the church. But this is also why, you know, conservative Catholics think of the current Pope as being like, you know, quasi-heretical himself, right?
Yeah, let me follow up on that. You mentioned Francis, who a lot of conservative Catholics despise, and, you know, like right. You said, consider him heretical. And by the way, if anybody out there listening is interested, there's some really good stuff that's been done on the kind of role of religion in the immediate Cold War period, kind of, you know, getting Americans to support the Cold War. Stephen Whitfield wrote a book about that many years ago, which I found useful, and, you know, talks about people like Father Coughlin before right. The war and the American Pope, but what the hell's his name? Spellman, Francis Cardinal Spellman. But Francis, when he was chosen, I mean, he's clearly different, let's say that, than J.P. Deuce and Benedict. But was that kind of a statement by the Vatican saying, well, you need to reel it in here, we're getting too far out, or by the bishops?
I think that's, in some ways, that's kind of how it's been read, you know? Yeah. I mean, the whole phenomenon is very strange, right? Because it's not completely unprecedented, but it was unprecedented in modern times for a pope to step down, right? For Benedict XVI to abdicate his position.
Oh, I don't know I that it's ever happened, yeah. In my lifetime, yeah.
Yeah, certainly not. And then, you know, there's, I think, enduring questions about, like, what's Benedict's, like, his continued kind of semi-role yeah. as emeritus.
Right, which has
not always been particularly helpful, I don't think.
Backbench Pope.
Yeah. But, you know, I think there's a way in which, you know, the election of Francis was considered to be, you know, if not an outright rebuke, an attempt to change course a bit. I think that's, you know, that's not really debatable. You know, they're so different in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, he's incredibly pastoral in contrast. So they're not just different in terms of, you know, policies, but they're also different in terms of demeanor.
Oh, sure, and, sure.
And I do think that we'll never know, like, what the actual debates were, but it does seem like the choice to move, at, you know, from, you know, you had JP2, then Benedict the 16th, who are both, I mean, JP2 was, he smiled a lot and, like, you know, he was, like, handsome. But JP2 and Benedict the 16th were both, like, incredibly reactionary people.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, Benedict the 16th just didn't mask it very well. And he actually got more conservative, you know, as he aged, which is not super surprising. But, you know, Pope Francis, yeah, it's like a kinder, gentler face of the Catholic Church for sure. In a sense, he's almost more like, I mean, he's not Dalai Lama-esque, but he has a kind of demeanor that I think people find very, just like, on a personal level, appealing.
Yeah, I was actually going to say, like, a lot of lefties I know love the guy. And, yeah. You know, I think, and it's funny, he has kind of almost like an RBG cult among a few people. But, I mean, you know, do you see a danger in that? Like, people on the left kind of, you know, investing him with all these things that really aren't there.
Yeah, well, I think it's, you know, like I said before, In a lot of ways, I mean, the papacy is more than just symbols, right? Because they, you know, there's policies and all sorts of, like, very, like, material things that come out of it. But, you know, a lot of what the Pope does is give symbolic gestures, you know, and, like, when Francis, you know, was first, right, people made, when he was first kind of brought in, people made a big deal out of him not sleeping in, like, the kind of palatial apartment. Everyone made a big deal of the fact that he wasn't wearing expensive footwear, because Benedict XVI was famous for wearing these, like I forget who made them. I don't know a lot of
like Prada or something. Like, yeah.
Prada. Yeah. Yeah. It was red Prada shoes. Right. Those are the, and that's symbolic of something. Right.
Yeah.
In addition, just being kind of awesome fashion, but, my favorite part of Benedict XVI was his Prada shoes. But, you know, I think, so there's this idea that Francis is communicating something just in the way he dresses, in the way that he moves, you know, in the way that sometimes, like, there's rumors that he, like, would escape into the town and just, like, walk around Rome at night, you know, like, undercover in just, like, a regular priest's clerical outfit. This kind of humility and a certain kind of, like, almost you know, salt of the earth type of personality, which is interesting because, you know, like, how do you get to that position if you're actually like a salt of the earth person, right? I mean, people are complicated, but framing him in that kind of way is, it's a frame, right? It's not the entire, you know, reality of his being. In terms of the dangers that you're asking about, you know, I think he's benefited a lot from his perception, you know, from the left has benefited a lot from the fact that he has like a very low bar, right? Yeah. So, you know, coming out of Benedict the 16th and JP II, and I mean, and even just like the papacy in general, right? You know, the fact that he can essentially not answer a question about homosexuality and that's treated as international news, right? It's like, you know, he gets praised for being not terrible,
yeah,
right? And you know, this was reminding me of, you know, the, you know, in Rochester, like in a lot of places, there's, you know, there's been a lot of BLM protests, and every once in a while we'll be marching by a restaurant where people will be, and you know, people will start yelling at the, you know, or a house or something, and people will start yelling at the people to join the protest. And then a couple of people will join the protest and everyone like loses their minds for them, right? Like, I've never been praised as much as someone who like settles their bar tab and then joins the protest is praised, right? And it's such a small act, but it's treated as like this revolutionary thing, right? They're like suddenly heroes. And I think, you know, people benefited from such a low bar where he can say like, who am I to judge about sexuality? And people are like, I can't believe he did this, you know?
Yeah.
or similarly, you know, you know, several years ago, he, you know, he formally apologized to indigenous people in Latin America for the church's history of colonialism. And that was treated as this like kind of amazingly revolutionary thing. But then he canonizes Junipero Serra, you know, who is in the United States an icon of colonialism, right?
Sure.
And people are like, well, you know, Serra wasn't that bad. He was like the nice colonial figure. And the idea is that, you know, if we're talking on the level of symbols, which is what saints are, and that, you know, that it's more than just whether Sarah was a nice guy or not, right? That's symbolic of kind of a continued valorization of the colonial project that Pope Francis is himself kind of participating in through that process. So, you know, I think he gets, I mean, he has it in a sense, like kind of easy, right? And the idea of like cult of personality, you know, I mean, Pope Francis is still like publishing things about, you know, what he calls gender theory, right? And, you know, and that's not super surprising because he's a Catholic Pope, right? But, you know, the hero of the left in terms of like a Catholic icon, like is continuing to publish things that, you know, is like deeply gender essentialist and, you know, transphobic, et cetera, right? So, you know, I think, yeah, he gets off pretty easy in some ways. Yeah.
I always tell my class that the best saint is Saint Monday, but I think, you know, we've gone on quite a bit and I don't really have anything left. So I want to thank you for coming. And I was going to ask if you thought that the mafia killed John Paul I because of the Banco Immobiliare scandal, but we can talk about that later.
But, the answer is clearly yes, but.
I actually like Godfather 3 too, but I was reading about that before the movie came out. So I always bought it as well. So. Anyway, it's been great. This is fascinating. Like I said, I grew up in this stuff, and so it's always kind of good to kind of go back and talk about it without having to go to mass on, you know, next week or anything like that or that kind of thing. So thanks so much, and I really look forward to seeing your stuff on Immolations and anything else you put out, and we'll let the listeners know about what you've done, and we'll put up links and things like that as well. So thanks so much.
No, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Yeah, it's been great talking to you. I'm glad you came on, that you joined us after we've been talking about it for a minute. Folks, you've been listening to Professor Jack Downey from the University of Rochester talking about Dorothy Day, the Catholic Worker Movement, and then so much more about Catholic politics and self-immolation. If you want to keep Green and Red non-corporate. We don't want to take money from Soros or Exxon or Chevron or the Koch brothers or anything like that. Please become a patron at patreon.com/greenredpodcast, or you can make a one-time donation at greenredpodcast.org, and then follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel on YouTube. And we will be talking to you later. Bye.